Hello and welcome to Mariology. This is Dr. Mark Miravalle. In our last lectures, we've been talking about Our Lady's role as the spiritual mother of all peoples, inclusive of the three maternal manifestations of that doctrine and role. Her role as human co-redemptrix with and under Jesus in the obtaining of the graces of redemption. Her role as mediatrix of all graces, that each and every grace of the redemption merited infinitely by Jesus, the new Adam, and secondly by Our Lady, the new Eve, would be distributed to humanity through Mary's intercession. Thirdly, her role as advocate, that she is bringing to the throne of Christ the King, her divine Son, the needs of humanity. Now, we are going to discuss in this lecture a century-old movement within the Church for the solemn definition of this fifth doctrine. So, we'll recall that there are four Marian dogmas, that she is Mother of God, her virginity before, during, and after the birth of Jesus, her Immaculate Conception, and the Assumption of Mary, body and soul, at the end of her earthly life. Those four dogmas speak about Mary's relationship with Jesus and her God-given prerogatives to be the human co-redemptrix, i.e., her Immaculate Conception preparing her to be the perfect partner with Jesus in this great work. So we're talking about prerogatives and Mary's relationship with Jesus, but in fact now there has been a movement to have a solemn definition of her relationship with humanity. We'll see in 1950, a group of international Mariologists will come to Rome and will put forward a votum or a petition to Pius XII for the solemn definition of Mary's universal mediation. And the rationale is important because they will say, now that all of Mary's earthly prerogatives and her relationship with Jesus has been defined, now it's time to solemnly define her relationship with humanity from heaven. But let's go to a summary of what led to the last two Marian dogmas, the dogmas of the Immaculate Conception and the Assumption. There are three foundations that led these various popes, Blessed Pius IX and Pius XII, respectively, to make this solemn definition of the Immaculate Conception and the Assumption. The first is the proper theological foundations. Obviously, for a doctrine to be solemnly defined as a dogma, there has to be the guarantee, the theological evidence, that this doctrine is clearly established in the sources of divine revelation. Now, one could argue, if it's already a doctrine of the Church, you know that it has to be in Scripture and tradition as authoritatively interpreted by the Magisterium. Otherwise, it wouldn't be a doctrine. Still, it's important to do a further confirmation of the particular doctrine in the sources of Revelation. And that process was done before the definition of the Immaculate Conception and the Assumption. Second foundation would be called hierarchical or ecclesiastical support. That is, the support from the bishops, from cardinals, from the bishops, from members of the clergy. And it's important to note that this is not a requirement for a solemn definition. Of course, the Pope, as Vicar of Christ, can exercise papal infallibility at his own discernment, at his own decision. But history shows that typically there is some manifestation of support by bishops as well as members of the extension of the Magisterium when they are, in fact, one in mind and heart with the Holy Father. So ecclesiastical support or hierarchical support is something to look for a sense of readiness or appropriateness for a solemn definition. And the third foundation is the petitions from the faithful. Now, once again, both in preparation and in the time preceding the dogma of the Immaculate Conception, as well as the dogma for the Assumption, millions of petitions were sent in by the vox populi, if you will, the voice of the people. This was seen as an expression of the sensus fidelium. Again, we've talked about that before. The common consensus of the faithful worldwide as an indication that the Holy Spirit is active and operative through the people of God. Now, that never happens in contradiction of the Vicar of Christ, but in complement with the Vicar of Christ. So the task before us is to examine whether or not the present movement for a fifth dogma, for a solemn proclamation of Our Lady as the spiritual mother of all peoples, always inclusive of her roles as co-redemptrix, mediatrix, and advocate, the way she expresses that spiritual motherhood, whether these three foundations are satisfied, are present, whether they confirm the foundation, and also the issue of appropriateness, as we'll discuss. Well, before we get into that comparison of the three foundations with the present movement, I want to offer a little history of the present movement. And I want to note this well as an important aside. Up to this point in the course, we have talked about all things Catholic and all official teachings of the Church, and obviously the requirement of a religious assent of mind and will to the manifest mind of the Pope, even when he's not speaking ex cathedra, as Lumen Gentium number 25 speaks of. In other words, everything we have mentioned up to this point is really a call for obedience and a call for acts of faith, because it does come through the papal magisterium. This is different, my friends. In other words, this question about a solemn proclamation, a solemn definition, making a fifth dogma of the existing doctrine, is something that is to be discerned. It's something that good people could differ on. I personally strongly would believe that there's a great appropriateness to this definition, but that's my position. I just want to be clear for those taking the course and listening to this lecture. This is not a litmus test for orthodoxy. However strongly I personally believe in the fruitfulness and the appropriateness of this definition, that's very different than saying a good Catholic should support this. So just as an appropriate context, this is something very near and dear to many hearts. And we're going to talk about the numbers of the people that, in fact, are petitioning our Holy Father for this dogmatic crowning of Our Lady at the same time. It is not a doctrine. The subject matter is doctrinal, right? We're not free to reject Our Lady's spiritual motherhood or her roles as co-redemptrix, mediatrix, and advocate, because they've been taught repeatedly and consistently by the ordinary magisterium. But the issue of whether this doctrine should be proclaimed a dogma is an issue for discernment. And once again, an issue that before it is defined in terms of appropriateness, good people can differ. So the doctrine, that we're bound to. The definition of it right now, that we're free to ponder and to discuss and even to disagree on. So having said that, let me give a little bit of a history of why this is a century-old movement within the heart of the Church. In 1915, the renowned Belgian cardinal, Cardinal Désiré Mercier, he was a World War I hero. He was even in the New York Tinker Tape Parade after World War I because of his leadership and his courage in speaking out against the unjust invasion of Belgium during World War I from Germany. He proposed and began a movement, a petition drive, for the solemn definition of Mary's spiritual maternity. Now, in the theological formulation of Cardinal Mercier, it's important to note, he always included Our Lady's role as co-redemptrix, her unique participation in the redemption, and mediatrix of all graces, which he would later be a principal instrument of petitioning, which for the liturgical feast of mediatrix of all graces, for which it was granted by Pope Benedict the 15th. So, but the actual specific title was Mary's spiritual maternity, but always buttressed, always supported in his articulation of that theologically, including her roles as co-redemptrix and mediatrix of all graces, her unique role in the redemption and her distribution of graces. Why did Cardinal Mercier begin this in 1915? Well, the situation was World War I, and Mercier believed that a solemn definition of Mary's spiritual motherhood of us would allow her to more powerfully enact those roles, that the definition which would actually activate her roles as our spiritual mother in interceding for peace for the world. Now, during World War I, that was an extremely relevant and critical fruit. So Mercier saw that this definition, he held and promulgated the concept that to solemnly declare her titles would really be to activate those roles for humanity, in particular, a great historic release of grace and peace for the world. So in May of 1915, he began this movement. Within the next 3 years, he got several hundred bishops, some 300 bishops, and hundreds of thousands of faithful to send petitions in to the Holy Father, at that time, Pope Benedict XV, for this solemn definition. Now, in the early 1920s, 1923, Father Maximilian Kolbe joined his voice for this solemn definition. And with the turn of the next Holy Father, with the election of Pope Pius XI, Pius XI was so committed to this possibility of a solemn definition that he had three theological commissions established, one in Spain, one in Belgium, one in Rome. Now, we have only officially the results of the commission in Spain and in Belgium. And those two theological commissions presented over 2,500 pages of theological support for both the truth and the appropriateness of a solemn definition of Our Lady as the spiritual mother of all peoples, her universal mediation. Now, the third commission was the Roman Commission. And we do know that one of the members of the Roman Commission, Father Reginald Guergou Lagrange, a very famous Thomist theologian in Rome, at the Angelicum in Rome, also was strongly in favor. So the only reference of a possible objection that came forward from the Roman Commission, and again, this has not been officially released, was a hesitation, and in fact, a negation, properly put, a rejection of this by a French cardinal from the Secretary of State for reasons of ecumenism, that he thought this definition would be against the Church's mission of ecumenism. And I raise that specifically because that will be the later and ongoing and even the major contemporary objection to this definition, even in our own day. Well, let's go to 1950. On December 1st of 1950, the principal Mariologists of the world came together in Rome, and just 1 month following the definition of the Assumption on November 1st of 1950, these Mariologists offered a unified petition of votum to Pope Pius XII, asking for the solemn definition or dogma of Our Lady's universal mediation. And again, the rationale is important, that now that all of Our Lady's earthly prerogatives and who Mary is in relation to Jesus have been defined as contained in the first four dogmas, now it's time to solemnly define Mary's relationship from heaven to humanity. And the sense was that this would complete Marian dogma. Why complete it? Because there's no other dogma, excuse me, there's no other doctrines remaining after this fifth proposed Marian dogma defining Mary's relationship to humanity, from heaven to humanity, her roles of intercession, her roles of motherly mediation. Now, as we come up to the Second Vatican Council, it's interesting to note that in the questionnaires that went out to all the to-be members of the Second Vatican Council, the bishops, the heads of religious orders, etc., the questionnaire about what you would like to discuss at the Second Vatican Council, there were two major requests for the council itself. The first was a condemnation of communism, and that, as we would see, would not take place. The second, in terms of quantity, was a solemn definition of Mary's role as our spiritual mother. Now, that was posed in different forms: the definition of Mary's spiritual maternity, the definition of Mary's role as mediatrix of all graces, even specifically the definition of Mary's role as the human co-redemptrix. That constituted the second major request at the second, before the Second Vatican Council, to be dealt with at the Second Vatican Council. Well, in the opening of the Second Vatican Council, Pope St. John the 23rd, under the inspiration of the Spirit, said that Vatican II would not be a dogmatic council. It would not be a council for defining new dogmas. Rather, it would be a pastoral council in applying the dogmatic truth of the Church already to the Church in the modern world today. Now, some took that as an indication that there would never be a fifth Marian dogma, or that there never should be a fifth Marian dogma because it was not defined at the Second Vatican Council. Well, that would be both theologically and historically incorrect. For example, at the First Vatican Council, there was a petition for the dogmatic definition of Our Lady's Assumption. And several hundreds of bishops were supportive of this, but it was decided that it was not the right time. And so, of course, we now know that the right time came in 1950 with the dogma of the Assumption. So the point, historical and theological, is simply because it wasn't done at the Second Vatican Council is no indication that it's not to be done and that it will not take place. There, again, apart from the doctrinal clarity, is the issue of opportuneness or appropriateness. And so with this history, we then have, soon after the Second Vatican Council, a continuation of petitions, particularly certain cardinals, Cardinal Gagnon, the Canadian cardinal, and others, who were gathering petitions from the hierarchy. And then soon after, there was a great wellspring of petitions coming from the laity. In an organization called the Vox Populi Mariae Mediatrici, Voice of the People for Mary Mediatrix. Therefore, in the last 25 years, there have been over 800 bishops and over 8 million petitions from over 180 countries for this solemn definition. So that kind of brings us historically up to speed about this international movement. And I would say also, incidentally, it's important that you're aware of this as a student of Mariology and on whatever level, because the two events that have hit most news, both Catholic and secular, regarding Our Lady, has been the issue of this proposed fifth Marian dogma and the issue of Medjugorje, which we will cover towards the end of the course. And therefore, it's appropriate that you be aware of this in terms of your contemporary knowledge of Mariology today. Let's now go back to those three criteria, those three foundations for definition, and at least do a basic examination of this movement in light of those three foundations. Number one, theological foundations. Is there theological evidence sufficient for a solemn proclamation of Our Lady's spiritual maternity? Well, once again, we realize that it is already a doctrine of the Church. And since Pope Sixtus IV in 1477, and ongoing, you've had the teaching of Our Lady as the spiritual mother of all humanity by the papal magisterium. Once we get into the 19th century through the 21st century, as we've talked about in our previous courses, there is consistent, explicit treatment of Our Lady's role, unique in the redemption, mediation of graces, and advocacy in the ordinary magisterium. That includes papal encyclicals, apostolic letters, audiences. It's the consistency of the papal teaching that establishes it as ordinary magisterium. St. John Paul II, using the title Co-Redemptrix some seven occasions, talking about the role of Mary in redemption dozens of times, as well, Mediatrix of All Graces, eight occasions for St. John Paul II, advocacy dozens of times, and leading inclusive of Pope Benedict XVI, and also in terms of the doctrine, in terms of the role, our present Holy Father, Pope Francis, as well. So in terms of theological support, remember those early three commissions came up even under the pontificate of Pius XI, which ran in the 1920s into the 1930s. There were already 2,500 pages of theological justification for the definition. Since that time, there have been well over 25 volumes of Mariology, many of which international Mariologists coming together to offer support for this solemn definition of Our Lady as the spiritual mother of all humanity. So the theology certainly has a foundation more than in any other place in the papal magisterium itself. In the second category of ecclesiastical or hierarchical support, once again, even in the time of Cardinal Mercier, there were over 300 bishops supporting this definition, and even before Mercier's death, several more hundred bishops, and he dies in the early 1920s. From the 1920s to 1993, only the Congregation for the Doctrine of Faith would have the total numbers. But as mentioned before, even since 1993, over 800 bishops, inclusive of over 55 to 60 cardinals, have petitioned the Holy See for the solemn definition. So it certainly in itself represents a very significant manifestation of the ecclesiastical support or hierarchical support. Remembering once again that in both these categories, 2 and 3, they're advisory. They're not required for a solemn definition. That is up to the Vicar of Christ himself. Third category, the petitions from the faithful. Well, once again, total numbers would only be contained by the Holy Office or presently by the Congregation for the Doctrine of Faith. But since 1993, over 8 million petitions from over 180 countries, and it's a great diversity. It's truly throughout the world. It's all five continents have sent in petitions to the Holy See. These are petitions that have been recorded in supporting this solemn definition. So, per annum, by the year, in the last 25 years, this movement for a fifth Marian dogma has been the largest petition drive in the history of the Catholic Church. And that should be given significant consideration, not ultimate, of course, but significant consideration if we're being true to the criteria that led to the last two Marian dogmas. Now, let's talk about appropriateness. And let's talk about reasons that are posed for the definition, and let's also talk about major objections to the definition. Why? Even if it's in the sources of Revelation, what would be arguments that would support this solemn definition? Well, first of all, as we mentioned, let's go back to 1950 again, and the intention and the desire of the Mariologists of the world in presenting a votum to Pope Pius XII. I've always wondered, the poor Holy Father had just exercised infallibility a month earlier, and now he's getting a petition for a new one. But the theological justification, I think, is most appropriate. Once all the prerogatives of Our Lady in relation to Jesus and gifts given her by the Father to fulfill her role had been satisfied. Now it was the right time. There was appropriateness. And so the idea that it would complete Marian dogma also, I think, rings true in terms of a reason to crown Our Lady with this definition. The opposite would be unusual, that what would be said, what would be kind of inferred if all of Our Lady's prerogatives in relation to Jesus and gifts of the Father, like the Immaculate Conception, let us say, were defined, but her relationship with us was purposely not defined. It would seem to underestimate, to undervalue Mary as the world's spiritual mother. And that, of course, is the gift of Jesus from Calvary. So, first reason is the completion of Marian dogma. Others have talked about a certain climax of the age of Mary, that indeed, since 1830, we've had more Marian dogmas, more Marian apparitions, more Marian popes, more Marian conferences, more Marian writing than in any other time in history. But it's always very important, my friends, that devotion, that love of Our Lady has its foundation in truth. So, for example, what is the theological foundations for things like Marian consecration, or even praying the rosary? Or what are apparitions, if not Mary's mediation in action? It is a manifestation, a historic, a supernatural manifestation that she is our spiritual mother. And so to solemnly define Mary's spiritual maternity, inclusive of those three elements, those three key elements, those three pillar elements, co-redemptrix, mediatrix, and advocate, would be to substantiate theologically acts of devotion. And that's always a critical balance, because we never want an act, even a desired act of love for Our Lady, to not be girded, to not be founded in the dogmatic and doctrinal teachings of the Church. So this was seen as a certain dogmatic truth climax in this great age of Mary that would support the love or devotion summit that we've seen in great popes like St. John Paul II, the Totus Tuus, in this age of consecration, consecrating the world to the Immaculate Heart of Mary, the spreading of consecration ubiquitously throughout the Church. And so that also was seen as a legitimate rationale to bring this climax age, this age of Our Lady, beyond any other age of Our Lady in the history of the Church, of which there's been prominent, to a proper dogmatic underscoring. Now, there's also been arguments for this definition from the domain of private revelation. I want to be very clear here. Private revelation can never be a foundation for a solemn definition. At the same time, history shows that private revelation can confirm, with a type of heavenly confirmation, a developmental movement in the Church. So we saw, for example, the effect of the miraculous metal apparitions, the Rudabach apparitions, that take place of Our Lady of Grace in November of 1830, that had such an impact on Blessed Pius IX to declare the dogma of the Immaculate Conception. Because, and of course, the medal, which started as a vision, are the words, O Mary, conceive without sin, pray for us who have recourse to thee. It's also true, and it's been recorded and confirmed, that Pope Pius XII had three solar miracles that he wrote about and sent to his family in Rome, surrounding the definition of the definition, surrounding the dogmatic definition of the Assumption on November 1st, 1950, in the Vatican Gardens, that he believed, again, this is in personal letters from Pius XII to his family, he believed that those solar miracles were confirmations of the definition of the Assumption. So let's be clear about the difference between foundation and confirmation. Foundation means it has to rest on scripture tradition as interpreted authoritatively by the magisterium. Confirmation is something that we should be open to because it's been used before by heaven to lead a development of doctrine to its dogmatic fruition. So in that context, I want to mention two apparitions in particular. Now, both of these apparitions have received the constat de supernaturalitate, the decision on the local bishop's level that these apparitions are of a supernatural origin. I mentioned first the apparitions of the Lady of All Nations in Amsterdam, Holland, apparitions from 1945 through 1959. And we'll discuss this a little bit more at the end of the course when we talk about the private revelation section. But these apparitions were given the approval of public devotion in 1996 after consultation with the Congregation for the Doctrine of Faith. And then in 2002, they were declared to be of a supernatural origin by the local bishop on the local church level. The first half of these apparitions revealed a number of what we might call geopolitical prophecies. And these prophecies served to gain credibility to the great request that happened in the second half of these apparitions. So what do we mean by geopolitical prophecies? For example, in 1945, Our Lady told the Dutch visionary Ida Pertemann that there would be the reunification of Israel. In 1945, that was fulfilled in the late 1940s. Also, that China would be under a red flag and there'd be much bloodshed. Of course, the communist takeover of China happens also in the late 1940s. In 1949, there's the prophecy of a civil war in Korea with lingering dangerous effects for humanity even long after. And that, of course, is the civil war in Korea, which led to the presence of North Korea. There's prophecies of warring in the Balkans, warring around Jerusalem. Even the prophecy of a great multinational ill effect from what would take place from Cairo. This was a 1947 prophecy, which in many ways resembles the, quote, Arab Spring that happened even within the last 6 or 7 years. Now, there's a long series of these. Our point, and we'll talk about these more specifically as they come, our point, including prophecies of an upcoming Second Vatican Council, a man on the moon, etc., an economic crisis, a spiritual decline of grave degree, all these things have indeed taken place. For example, Dr. Richard Russell, who was an instructor for the CIA, mentioned that this Dutch woman in the 1950s knew more about world events than the combined intelligence of the American CIA and the Russian KGB. How is this possible without a supernatural intervention, was the conclusion of Dr. Russell. So all those geopolitical prophecies really prepare for what comes in the second part of the message, starting soon after the dogma of the Assumption on November 1st, 1950. So almost in a private revelational parallel to the international Mariologists coming and asking for this fifth dogma, Our Lady begins to ask specifically for the proclamation of the dogma of Mary as co-redemptrix, mediatrix, and advocate. In February 11th of 1951, she will reveal a prayer that she says should be prayed in preparation of this dogma. And then in a series of messages that run from 1951 through 1954, she specifies repeatedly the imperative for a dogma of Mary as co-redemptrix, mediatrix, and advocate. And it's really a very rich series of messages concerning how Mary is particularly and precisely co-redemptrix and mediatrix and advocate. There's a lot of rich Mariology in these messages. But most importantly, and in the message of May 31st, 1954, she brings this to a head by saying that only with the proclamation of the dogma of Mary as co-redemptrix, mediatrix, and advocate will the Lady of All Nations be able to intercede for, in her words, peace, true peace for the world. And so these Amsterdam apparitions seem to confirm the call of Fatima for, indeed, an era of peace, a gift of peace to the world. At Fatima, she says, in the end, my Immaculate Heart will triumph. A period of peace will be granted to the world. But that it is contingent, it is conditional on the proclamation of Our Lady as the co-redemptrix, mediatrix, and advocate. We'll make a mention about the theology of that in just a moment. Now, soon after, we have a second apparition. And again, we're talking only about potential confirmation of the opportunists of a fifth Marian dogma now. In 1973, a statue of the Lady of All Nations, and let's be clear, the Lady of All Nations is the title in which she comes under in Amsterdam, and it's Our Lady standing in front of the cross of Jesus. Her arms are outstretched, and she's standing on a globe, and there are many sheep representing the nations throughout the world. Some sheep are looking up to the cross, very few. The majority are not. And Our Lady in Amsterdam said that's why she's coming, is to return the nations, the peoples, to the cross of Jesus. Well, that very image is made, is carved into a wooden statue for a Japanese convent. And in the summer of 1973, that image of the Lady of All Nations begins to exhibit supernatural mystical phenomena. And again, let me just go quickly to the declaration of the local bishop, Bishop John Ito, in 1984, who said, after examination, after medical examination, after consultation with the Congregation for the Doctrine of Faith, he declared the events in Akita, A-K-I-T-A, to be of a supernatural origin. So this is the second apparition approved by the local bishop that is linked to the request at Amsterdam for a fifth Marian dogma. As she appears, and really there's locutions that come forward from this statue of the Lady of All Nations in Akita, Japan, there are a number of other phenomena. The most predominant would be that the statue weeps on 101 occasions. And the visionary, Sister Agnes Sasagawa, who's miraculously cured from her deafness, from her handicap, her special condition of being deaf, at the end of these apparitions, which was promised, these mystical phenomena, she herself experienced the stigmata in her hand, which mirrored blood weeping, blood dripping, if you will, from the statue also, from the hand of the statue. So a whole series of mystical phenomena, but the 101 occasions of the weeping, according to the visionary, represented the 101 signified by the one being Eve, the zero in the middle being God in his eternity, and the second one symbolizing Our Lady as the new Eve. And that's why the spiritual director of Sister Agnes would write a book on Mary co-redemptrix, seeing this, of course, as the continuation it is from Amsterdam. In fact, Bishop Ito, the bishop from Akita, would journey in pilgrimage to Amsterdam in confirmation of the essential link between Amsterdam and Akita. So once again, we're simply talking about the category of private revelational confirmation with these two local church-approved apparitions that first is calling and then confirming the call for a fifth Marian dogma. Now, let's examine the major objection to this solemn proclamation. And it is the objection that was voiced by the French cardinal from the Secretary of State as a member of the Roman Commission, at least as it is commonly discussed in theological journals, and that is that a definition would violate the Christian call of ecumenism. Well, let's examine that briefly. And we're going to talk a little bit more about ecumenism when we talk about St. John Paul II's treatment of ecumenism in his single Marian encyclical, Redemptoris Mater. Essentially, ecumenism, as it's defined by St. John Paul II, is prayer as its soul, dialogue as its body, seeking Christian unity in the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. And in his famous encyclical on ecumenism, it's 1994 encyclical, Ut Unum Sint, the Holy Father says that you cannot use this call, this imperative of Christian unity, as a justification for compromising doctrine or the development of doctrine. And he says this especially and particularly includes the doctrinal developments regarding Our Lady. So to state that ecumenism is in itself a prevention of Marian dogma would be a misunderstanding of ecumenism as the Church herself defines ecumenism. And again, we'll discuss this in more detail when we get to John Paul II's treatment of ecumenism in Redemptoris Mater, as well as he talks about it in his encyclical on ecumenism, Ut Unum Sint. I would summarize this by a letter that was written by the late Cardinal John O'Connor of New York to St. John Paul II in support of this definition for a fifth Marian dogma, because it deals with this subject very acutely. In this letter, Cardinal O'Connor states that a solemn definition of Mary's role as spiritual mother of all peoples under these three aspects would actually assist ecumenism. Why? Because it would be a papal articulation of exactly who Mary is and what she does in redemption, but also who Mary is not. In specific, that Mary is not God, and that Catholics do not adore Mary. They do not see Mary as a fourth person of the Trinity. And Cardinal Connor's point was, that'll serve authentic ecumenism, both in terms of praying together, but also in terms of authentic dialogue. How wonderful it would be to enable Catholic ecumenists to have this document, which states very clearly that Catholics do not place Mary on a level of equality with God. So from a theological perspective, it would be an inaccurate understanding of ecumenism to say that ecumenism in itself violates a Marian dogma, because that would in itself prevent logically the other Marian dogmas which have happened and happened for the glory of God and for the proper dignity of Our Lady. And I would also point to two individuals in closing here, two individuals that of the 20th century are arguably the greatest images, the greatest icons of full love of Mary and full ecumenical dedication. The first is, ironically, Cardinal Mercier. Cardinal Mercier was the leader of his time in the ecumenical movement. He was also the one who starts the petition drive for the fifth Marian dogma. The second would be, of course, St. John Paul II. No one made greater strands in terms of Christian unity, greater victories than Pope St. John Paul II. And yet he was the totus tuus Pope. He was fully Marian. So can you be fully Marian and fully ecumenical? Not only can we be, but we should all strive to be. These are not contradictory. These are complementary. And ultimately, there is the belief that Our Lady can unite Christians in ways we simply cannot do on our own, because she is the spiritual mother of all peoples. So one can continue to discern the movement for the fifth Marian dogma. As mentioned, many have written to our present Holy Father for this proclamation. People are free to do that. The address of the Pope is His Holiness Pope Francis, 00120 Vatican City. And it's always within the canonical rights and even the obligations of the faithful to bring to the pastor of the church issues that we believe are important. This is Canon 212. There's a sense of a moral obligation to bring it to the father of the family as respectful children, but then also to be respectful of the final definitive judgment of the father. So it is always a Catholic precedent and a Catholic privilege to petition the Holy Father. It should always be done with respect and obedience to his final definitive judgment, but we can continue in that process as he discerns the appropriateness of a solemn declaration, what's sometimes called the crowning of Our Lady, where she is recognized as co-redemptrix, mediatrix, and advocate, which then allows her to most fully activate those roles for the church and for the world today. Well, thank you for being with us in this lecture of Mariology. This is Dr. Mark Miravalle saying again, God bless you all, and let's all do our best in seeking to bring life and love to the words of Jesus regarding his mother and our mother, to behold our mother. God bless you all.